Well, the fact is that no one would give John a record deal. Yes, I had a label, but I was very aware of the conflict. I was also his manager, and I really felt it would be a conflict of interest to put him on my own label. So I, as his manager, was trying to get him an outside record deal. And there wasn't a record company in the country and in America that wanted to offer him a deal. I got rejected from every quarter. And in the end, there's no doubt that, yes, I had to put a mortgage on the house and everything else that I had at the time to pay for what was going to be a very expensive album for its time, because it had to be. We had to demonstrate that John had the ability to do this.
We had the chance to turn the pages over. We can write what we want to write. We gotta make ends meet before we get much older.
Radio stations did not want to play Whispering Jack simply because it was Johnny Farnham. The FM stations at the time, no matter how good it was, basically said to my face point blank, we will never add this record because it's Johnny Farnham. We're not going to add a Johnny Farnham record. And that was a major frustration. The only way that we ended up getting it was because it was basically through requests. We finally started to get spot airplay on radio. And every time it was played, the phones rang off the hook. The radio stations virtually had to be forced into playing the record. And once we got You're the Voice away and it became a number one record, and Whispering Jack became number one, we never really looked back. I mean, it stayed at the number one position for 27 weeks, which is an extraordinary effort. But the first week it actually got to number one, with the feeling of relief that was in John was amazing. And I remember driving him home, and I'm concentrating on driving, and he's sitting in the passenger seat next to me, and I'm trying to emphasize to John, we've got the number one album. Do you understand that, you know, can you believe that we actually have the number one album in the country? All those people out there have put us at the top. And it was just silence from John, and I'm driving, I looked aside, and he was crying.
How you feeling, mate?
Oh, take the pressure down.
And very, very, very close friend.
Who doesn't play?
Glenn Wheatley, who doesn't play a thing, but he's great just around. Mr. Vibe, drinking the Evian water, this is good.
What was it about that record?
The quality of songs. I mean, you've got Pressure Down, you've got, you know, good songs.
Was there a Ross Wilson song on there?
Yeah, Touch of Paradise.
Touch of Paradise.
So I mean, we did all of that, and but it was an extraordinary piece and still stacks up today.
Everybody, Well, I guess the nervous part about it for all of us, Don, is the fact that we don't know yet. I mean, this is officially our first engagement since John has joined the band. We've basically been in the studio.
Mm.
And time will tell. You know, we're all very confident, of course. We feel that it's going to work. But no matter what the band does at the moment now, I think that they're going to be coming under the biggest microscope in the world because there's a lot of attention being put onto the thing, and there's a lot of pressure on the guys as well now to really go out and deliver with this whole thing.
Look, it's fair to say John, as much as it helped him a lot to get into America and play the big stages, he was always a bit uncomfortable, and he'd never quite...
What, taking on the Glenn old Shorick's, songs?
Well, yeah.
And Glenn's and arrangements?
Yes, and having to fill Glenn's shoes. Look, John's a fine singer, there's no doubt about him, and he brought his own style to the whole thing.
Were there any hesitations, any doubts all the time you were working? I mean, rehearsing, recording, doing all of those things?
I think so. There were a lot of rumours floating around beforehand that John and us were getting together.
It had been premeditated. They were only rumours.
You mean people thought that you had planned this whole thing way? Yeah. Was it always Glenn? Was it always John that you were talking about, or was it a bunch of people you were thinking of?
There was only ever one person that we thought about, and that was John.
Just John.
Uh huh.
Okay.
Well, I was the only one they knew.
Fair to say there were conflict of interest with the other members as well. There's an element that they felt that John was doing too much on stage because John's a showman. And he'd get up on stage, and he's all over the stage doing this whole thing, you know, and doing it, what John does. And the rest of the band thought, no, look, we're a band, you know. And
so really, they were a bit shocked by his flamboyance.
And it was a bit too much for them. And it was always a tense little thing. And there was at one stage, I can tell you the story, that they actually taped his mic lead, gaffered it to the stage to stop him working the whole stage.
Wow.
And John, it took John about 5 seconds to wrench the thing and just pull this thing up, and because no one was going to stop doing what John Farnham does, you know. He works an audience. He's a communicator. But I knew that we had something, and particularly by the time that we found You're the Voice, which was the last song we found for this album, but the moment it arrived in the office, it had John Farnham written all over this. And when I got to play it to John, he just said, oh, I'll own this.
We're all someone's daughter. We're all someone's son. Hello, give him a good show.
that song I treat as sacred ground for John and I. I mean, I very rarely let it use for any third party usage. I mean, and I control it because it's a very special song to us. And it deserves.
Does he sing it every time he performs?
He has to, but he wants to as well. I mean, the audience would kill him if he didn't. I mean, it's become, as you know, as Coldplay said, it's become, you know, the national anthem. But it's a very important part of our lives, as Whispering Jack became a very important part of our lives. And once the moment that song got to number one and the album got to number one, Whispering Jack stayed at number one for 26 weeks.
Wow.
6 months. Every week. I mean, I was getting people like Dennis Hanlon at Sony. He said, mate, I got the Michael Jackson album. He said, just let me have 1 week. You know, I said, well, it's not me, after me, mate. Everyone's still buying it.
Yeah.
Week after week after week, we kept it at number one.
Tonight, best single, best album, best male performance in a video, and most outstanding achievement, John Farnham, You're the Voice.
John always says, you know, it was his second bite at the cherry, and he went through a very emotional time because he put his heart and soul into Whispering Jack, and that tension when he delivers it to you, and I remember the cassette that it was in those days, the handwritten on there saying, dear boss, this is the best that I can do, good luck, and just signed it. And I've kept that ever since. I mean, what he did was he was handing over what was his best that he could do. And I had to go and get a deal, and he knew that I was getting rejections everywhere.
Like Kylie, John Farnham found he wasn't cool enough for radio station playlists.
You know, we did the usual, put it out on a white label without his name on it and take it out to radio. Because if it had John Farnham or Johnny Farnham on it, we knew that they'd just instantly say, we don't play Johnny Farnham.
Once you've made it in America, you'll always maintain a level. Here, gone. And then you've got to fight your way back up. He was always going to come back. But in reality, it should never have gone away. The guy was always, all of a sudden he wasn't any better than he was there, you know, but that's us, that's Australia, kick them when they're down and bury them and forget about them.
There was a rumour going around that RCA had pressed only 5,000 copies of the album in the beginning. I think that is a rumour. I don't think that they pressed anything like that.
Sorry,
I'm
I love the smell of napalm in the morning.
I reckon I've got 20 minutes to make up our minds to whether the show goes on tonight or not.
Where's the box office over there?
Box office is there.
Foyer's not up. They've got to completely set up their whole foyer and do that. They've only got one air conditioning plant. They don't have the band's dressing room not here. We're still trying to find out where it is. 600k away, 500k away at the moment.
And why don't we know? Because their mobile phones are flat.
That's right.
Yeah, and they're using fucking digital.
Well, Telstra got their flags up.
What is it, mate?
It's your Telstra mobile phone bill, mate.
Well, you're the manager, you better have it.
I don't know, it's not my bill.
It's all right, you win.
Join selected Telstra Mobile More for You plans for 12 months and be rewarded. Every month you'll get a bonus of up to $20 off your bill.
Tell you what, mate, you can have this one.
Oh, no, that's definitely yours.
No, I've already got one.
That's your bill, mate.
Want a monthly bonus?
More bill.
Only Telstra has more for you. Call 125-111 or visit your Telstra Mobile Net dealer.
So it's me, mate.
Sweet.
Looks like I'm not going to be able to make it in.
Oh. Mate, that's a shame.
Yeah, I really wanted to see you wrap it up, mate. Could you do me a favour and put your mobile near the speaker and I'll hear it anyway?
We're going to be here for hours. It'll cost you a fortune.
Not with Telstra.
The most you'll pay is $1.98 per call from your home phone to a Telstra mobile any night with Homeline Plus.
Let's tighten that up a little bit, just in a little.
Oh.
That's how you...
Oh, Glenn, this is the fifth call today. It's got to be costing you.
No, mate, the more calls I make, the cheaper it can get.
Is that right? Hey, Glenn.
John. Later, okay.
Join Telstra Mobile More for You and be rewarded.
Hey, wait.
With a call rate that can reduce each month depending on the number of calls you make.
I'm gonna kill him!
Want a reducing call rate? Only Telstra has more for you. Call 125-111 or visit your Telstra Mobile Net dealer.
G'day, Wheat.
Where are you? You know the big meeting's about to start.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, well, you're coming in loud and clear. You must be just around the corner.
Yep, I'm on my way.
You'll get clearer reception from more places with Telstra MobileNet CDMA, the network that gives more coverage to more Australians.
Hello?
Mate, where are you now?
Well, it won't be long, Wheat, so I'm just stuck in traffic.
Go with the network that offers you more.
You'll never believe who I'm in a shop with. Hello? Sal, hello?
Telstra Mobile Net.
Thanks.
Telstra's indoor coverage makes Telstra Mobile Net far and away Australia's best.
I'm in a shop with the voice. Hello? John Farnham. Yeah, I know. And guess who else is here? Paul Hogan. I've got to go.
How are you
going? Hi, John. How are you?
Good, thank you.
You've been friends with Glenn for a really long time, and you seem to have a fairly brotherly relationship. And I was just wondering, do you fight like real brothers?
Yeah, we actually do. We actually do. We fight like sisters. It's even worse. It's shocking. But we do have a terrific relationship. Glenn and I have been friends for many, many years. We do get on. The Telstra ads were a lot of fun. They were actually based on true fact. I mean, he does get recognised as Paul Hogan when we travel overseas. Of course, Gaynor hates that. Everyone thinks he's Linda Kozlowski, which I think is very funny. Oh, please, this is a setup.
Hello? No, he's busy. He's doing it. He's working at the moment.
Who is it?
It's for you.
It's not Stevie Wonder, is it?
No.
Ray Charles? Is it Ray Charles?
No, he needs to talk to you fast.
Tom Jones. It's Tom Jones.
No.
Oh, it's Elton. I bet it's Elton. Oh, that's so set up. It's shocking. Hello.
Hey, wait. I'm very...
I'm just very concerned. No, I'm very concerned. I heard you backstage before talking to the crew.
You can take the phone off. I can see you now. Gosh, I can read your lips.
And I'm just concerned that you've gone too far. At my expense, you were talking about the Harbour Bridge story, and I'd rather you didn't go there. Because
the Harbour Bridge story. Oh, thank you for bringing that up.
Because I am your manager, and I like to keep some sort of credibility. And I just
Do you want to tell 20% of the story, or leave the other 80% to me, or? No. That's funny. True story. Glenn actually takes it upon himself. You know, I'm a hands-on manager. He's bloody Superman, and he insists on driving me everywhere when we go anywhere, particularly in Sydney. You know, Sydney's a hard place to get around if you don't really know the place that well. And we were on the Harbour Bridge. We were heading towards the North Shore, and of course, the entertainment centre, it's on the other side. But we were going completely the wrong way, and I actually couldn't believe this. And I turned to Glenn, I said, Glenn, he said, I know, which is really quite funny. And I'm thinking, geez, what's going on? This man's an airhead, you know, and he's in charge of my life. So we get there, and we naturally turn around to drive back over the bridge to get on. And I swear, this is true. I'm not making this up. This isn't as set up as the phone gag, but he actually patted his pockets and went, ooh, ooh. I haven't got any coins. This is true. This is where those shelter ads come from. He didn't have a razoo on him. Not even a bloody credit card. And I never carry money when I'm going to work because the band picks my pockets. I know that for a fact. Has anyone ever tried to get across the Harbour Bridge without paying? It ain't easy. But I'm the ticket, see? And that's what tends to happen. You know, we go to a club, get the ticket, push me up the front, you know? Oh, Johnny, yeah, come in, mate. Yeah, you got your mates with you, no worries. Which is fantastic. But we're on the bridge and this woman stops and Glenn said, but, and I went, hello. And she went, g'day, Johnny, here you go. And I actually told her the story and she took money out of her purse, dropped it in and we got through. And if she's watching, thank you very much, dear. It was great. But that's true.
John, we've got to talk.
Hang on, mate, I just got to finish this mix.
It's about the tour, mate.
Oh, it won't be long, Glenn.
We need a name for the tour.
Glenn, this is the last time.
That's it!
I love it!
Yes!
John Farnham, the last time. It all comes down to this. 35 years of music in 2.5 hours. Tickets on sale Monday.
It's the last time. I love it! Woohoo!
I'm taking numbers for complaints, and I'll get to everybody as soon as I possibly can.
Take a seat, John.
Thank you, mate. Take a seat.
That's better.
This is like dealing with Paul Dainty.
Yeah.
I feel like Paul McCartney. Well, the question was,
where's
your spot? Real pass?
Back home.
This is probably the worst offence of the tour.
Oh no, there's one other worse offence. Getting me with the trousers down.
I know you're sick of hearing the sound of my voice yet. Otherwise, I could go on.
Yeah.
I have to leave because I think you're a dork.
The show was good, but that bloody voiceover.
Yeah, voiceover man.
Nuts.
Get rid of the voiceover.
He liked the sound of his own voice.
I think I called the singer a dork too. But there you go.
I'm going to go on. I'll dig you later, man.
In your own time, mate. Any time now.
Presence about him. There's something about his performance and his ability to put in, and he will be sweating so profusely. It looks like someone's throwing a bucket of water over him at the end of every show, because that's how much effort he puts into it. He puts every ounce of strength into it, and he sings it, puts himself at the top level of his range, and he could fake it. He could drop everything a tone. No. You'll come opposite. There's no blood there.
I don't shop. You know, it's very difficult for me to go shopping. Because first of all, if I walk into a jewellery shop, they go, oh, bloody beauty. Because, you know, they think, you know, they think, you know, they think Wheatley's paying me really well. He thinks he's paying me really well, which is really scary. Anyway.